beautiful people, I have a very interesting story to tell you guys today. Yesterday, for the very first time in my life, I got to try another Montana first, another first for me. But I would say that for any city boy to come into the country and try this, this is a first for anyone, to be quite honest. Before I get into what it is, my father-in-law is an amazing support to this community, and if someone asks him to go and do something for them, he usually will go and do it. He knows the value of helping other people, and it's a pay it forward, of course, but not only that, the community supports itself here. Everyone helps each other. So it's a real blessing when you can be an encouragement to someone else, and usually you get rewarded for it one way or another. This is something that he's starting to teach me as I'm getting involved in things around here. And so someone got in contact with him and asked him if he'd like to be part of branding. And he said yes, and he said he'd bring his son-in-law along. Yippee! I admittedly told him I wasn't quite interested, but after talking with me a little bit more about it, I agreed to go, and we got on the road at 5:30 in the morning and got there at about 7:30. So basically, we got out to the ranch that we were going to be doing this branding at, and of course, I've never been a part of it, so I didn't know what to expect. The only reason I had any idea about what I was about to see was because I've watched Mike Rowe and Dirty Jobs. If you've ever watched Mike Rowe and Dirty Jobs, that may connect some dots for you. But basically, we got out there, and as soon as I stepped out of the truck, I felt like I was on a farm, because truth be told, the sound was deafening of the cattle. It was just cows mooing, calves mooing for their moms. It was just incredibly loud. And then as we're out there, some dogs came up. There was a rabbit hopping around somewhere. I mean, it felt like a farm. And the thing that really reminded me it was a farm, it only took about 10 to 15 seconds of stepping out of the truck to realize it. Oh, and there's the smell. Woo, hello. That's farmland. Oh, it stank. It stank. You could smell the cow pies from a mile away. It was nasty. Very nasty. But you get used to it after a little bit. And honestly, my desire to understand what was going on around me definitely overwrote my senses of my nostrils, because I got on my jacket and I went for a walk and immediately started stepping in mud, and I was really thankful I had my muck boots, which I thought I was buying them originally just to go hunting with my father-in-law. Well, no, they got broken in yesterday for sure. So in walking around, I'm noticing that the cattle are really, really loud, and it seemed a little overly so, and I wasn't certain why. But looking over top the railings, I realized what was going on. The farmers were separating the moms from the calves, and the moms weren't too happy about it. But the thing that was amazing to me is how well the organizational process worked. They had a whole bunch of different pens, and they were able to immediately start sorting the cattle a little bit at a time. They had sticks. The sticks were very flimsy, very flexible, and they would just use them to tap the cattle very gently. They weren't poking at them too hard or anything. I mean, they have very tough skin as well, but truth be told, they were being very gentle with them. And they were splitting them apart and sending the moms one direction and the calves another direction. And then once I saw them have all the calves penned in separate from the moms, then I watched them go into the calves and separate them into two separate groups. There were orange tags and yellow tags. And what I learned is that two of the people that were there on the ranch at the moment that we were there, they were two owners of two different herds. And so basically they were taking the herds and separating them into two and then branding each herd with its proper mark. So once everything was sorted out, I started watching this, and they're like, hey, when you're ready to hop on in. And I'm like, well, I don't know where to start, so let me go ahead and film a little bit of what you guys are doing, and then I'll get started. What I noticed is that they took some of the calves and they moved them into a smaller pen. And once they had them in that smaller pen, then literally they would guide one calf at a time into a chute that's literally about this narrow, quite literally about that narrow. It's amazing how big these calves are and how tightly they can fit into smaller areas, much like a cat would going under a door frame or something. It was really impressive. And these calves would be led into this little pen, but what would happen is that there are hooks on this wall over here, and these hooks would come down very gently and lock the calf into the one wall. It would wrap one part around the neck and one part around the torso of the body. then that wall would be lifted, and I'm going to turn my hand like this to better demonstrate this. This wall here with these hooks that come out this way would be lifted, and it would turn into a table with the calf locked down on top of the table. And while the calf is locked down on top of this table, they would shave him, brand him, which was a very interesting smell. The calf was not too happy about it. And then what they would then do is they would look carefully over the calf. They would check and see if its body was looking okay, if it looked healthy, if its eyes looked okay, if they looked clear. Among the different things that they would do, they would give them shots to make sure if they needed to have a couple different medications, they could supply those for the calf. They would look for if the calf was bloated. They had some very large horse pills, and I called them cow pills.
All right, so some of these cows sometimes get a little bloated. That's because they've eaten the wrong kind of foods or something and they need to have some care done. You call Dr. Poole or whatever. But what these guys will do is they'll give them a special pill. They have to take that pill and they have to shove it deep down their throat so they'll swallow it. So they have something that kind of sends it down. This is that pill. Look at how huge that is. That's not a horse pill, that's a cow pill. I wouldn't take that for $1 million. Maybe I would. But I might need the Heimlich after that.
That they would feed into the cow's mouth with a very long syringe. They would put it all the way down the throat and release it so that way they didn't have to force it to swallow. And then what they would do is then they would tip that table back up, release those clamps, and it would go running out into the field. I remember the micro episode where he's talking about how they would handle banding versus... Okay, I'm a little ahead of myself here, but bear with me. One of the other things that they did is banding. And banding basically means if you're a bull, they would castrate you. And the way that they would do that is in a form of banding. It's a rubber band that they would wrap around the testicles. And basically what it would do is over a week's period of time or whatever, the testicles would lose blood supply and they would literally fall off as a dead, unnecessary part. And I remember watching a micro episode where, and watching several videos on micro talking about this, where he saw the same thing happen with sheep and how they would band the sheep and stuff. And this is the only reason why it didn't catch me off guard on what I was seeing. But they would take this rubber band and they would grab the testicles and they'd wrap the rubber band around the testicles and release it. And then they'd send the calf on its way. The one thing that I noticed after branding, which I know was absolutely painful for the calves, and after having their testicles wrapped, which I'm certain is painful, I can only assume, as soon as they stuck the table up and they released it, the calf would go prancing away. He looked perfectly fine. I'm sure he didn't appreciate the branding, but he looked perfectly fine. And throughout the day, as I'm watching this go on and smelling the burning of like hair, singed hair and skin, it was a smell that was not easy to get over. And when I did finally get over it, then it kind of turned on you and you started smelling it more and it became a little nasty to smell. And I could see a lot of the ranchers really did not like to brand their own cattle. And it made me think about some things. It made me think, well, what if they had some kind of electronic device where they could scan the cattle to see whose was whose instead of using a brand and stuff. And I talked with Ed about that. I talked to the ranchers about that. And the cost for those sort of things is super expensive. And truth be told, there are lots of farmers who will take other people's cattle if the brand is not completely clear. So it's very easy to either mistake or thieve from other farmers. And that's why the brand is so important. The brand grows as the cow grows, and that brand becomes very big on the side of the cow. So if you're trying to sell a cow with a brand on its side that's not yours, then it's then obviously there's something going on. So a brand is still a necessary evil, even in this day and age when we're trying to take better care of the animals. The other thing that was really, really cool, that really kind of set the standard for me, that really just blew my mind, was that I watched a farmer go over to a very little girl. She had just turned 10 years old. And he asked her to go out into the field and go get a ATV or a four-wheeler and bring it over to the farm. And she said, okay. She grabs her stick, and it's a little flimsy, pokey stick, and she goes into the big pen with the huge cows. Those cows admittedly scared me. When I saw them and they're looking at you and they're mooing at you, you swear they're ready to run you down. It's a scary thing to see. And I watched this little girl go into the pen and literally just walk right through them. And my mind was absolutely blown. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. The cows were stepping away from her and she walked right through. It was really difficult for me to swallow at first, but then I realized that the cows are scared of humans. They're very finicky, just as much as the calves are. In their growth process, they don't become less scared. And in talking with someone a little later in the day, I found out it was very interesting with what she had to say.
The cows seem to be just as skittish as their calves are. You can move them around with just a shush. Of course, you don't want to be kicked by them. It'll hurt a lot more. What's that? Yeah. Ed was saying that you guys have kind of trained them pretty well. They're pretty almost hand-fed. Yeah? No, I'm impressed, though. And the thing that helped me, honestly, and I don't know her name, but the little gal, watching someone telling her to go and, like, go get one of the other four-wheelers, and she goes through the pack of the big cows to the back there.
It's safe. I don't worry about it. Except when the cows are babies.
Yeah.
Than anyone else.
It's just amazing.
Protect their calf.
Sure, absolutely.
She said that she wasn't scared for the little girl because all the calves and the cows are oftentimes hand-fed by one of the hands. And that was really, really neat. These were literally tame cows. And they would hear the voice of the farmer and they would come running up and they would eat out of his hand or eat out of a bucket. And they've become very tame and very affectionate towards the farmers. So what was happening this day while all the cows are being scared and all finicky and stuff, this is not their normal day. Their normal day is out in this big, humongous field out in the open to do what they please. And then when food comes in, they're ready for food. And they know who has the food. The farmer has the food, and they're excited for it. And I heard some really amazing stories. And the long story short of everything that I heard that day is that whatever I was watching this day, watching all these calves get burned with the branding, or watching all these cows as they're put through a chute and getting injections put in them and getting stuff sprayed on top of them, it really opened my eyes to what I have missed that the TV has shown me. The TV is very quick to show you things that farmers are doing bad towards the animals, how they're abusing the animals, and oh my goodness, do you see what they're doing, how they're branding them, and how they're doing all this and blah, blah, blah. And it's a terrible thing that the TV has done, because you do not see the relationship between the farm animal and the farmer, especially these farmers. Now, these farmers did let me know that their cows were tamed, but other farmers prefer to actually keep their cows less tamed and prefer them to be a bit rampagey. And they say, now, the one thing that we are careful of is we do not let our farmers go amongst the cows while they're with their calves, because if, God forbid, something were to happen to the calf, and the mom gets spooked because the calf is hurt, or you're trying to do something with her calf, then the cow will protect its young. And that's one of the important reasons why separating the cow from the calf in the beginning of the day was so important. So I, at the end of the whole day, was really, really impressed with what I was seeing, because it was a really new eye-opening experience for me, and it gave me a new understanding of what I felt I was missing because of normal TV and what normal TV wanted to sell to me, which was that animals are being abused, which they are, but these farm animals weren't, and it was really cool to see. Then it was my turn to get into the pen. And I was nervous because, like I said, there's this tiny little area where you're standing with all these cattle, and then you take each one at a time and you guide it into the chute. And that chute then has that table that lifts up. And so my job now was to get into this muck, into this area where the cows are peeing and pooping and whatever. And I have to say, I know a lot of people think cows are cute, and they are cute to an extent, but they're a filthy bunch of animals. I mean, seriously, it was nasty. You look at their butts and they have poo and pee hanging out the back, and you have them rustling up against your body, and it's not all it's cracked up to be, I promise you. You think they're cute, but TVs, paintings, and all that stuff have made it look a lot better than it really is, I gotta say. So I get in there with all the calves. I'm scared stiff that I'm gonna, and please excuse the term I'm going to use because I know it's a little foul, but I was really nervous I was going to get my balls kicked in, quite honestly. There's just so much that, even with these little calves here around me that are literally waist high, maybe stomach high on me, they're, you don't know. You watch us try to pick and move them and stuff, and they get feisty and they start kicking you and stuff. And so you gently move one, and the farmer told me to cover over the eye on the side, basically, that you kind of wanted it to turn or whatever, because basically since they can't see that way, all they can think to do is go towards the open area that you're guiding them to. Very cool techniques that I learned from one guy named Wayne. So Wayne, if you're watching this, thank you for all the advice you gave me, for sure.
It's not as easy as it looks, okay? My hip is realizing that it's there. My muck boots are officially muck boots. They're covered in muck, that's for sure. And now I know why some people tuck their pants on the inside. It makes a bit of sense now. Now, is it Mom or you who prefers to tuck on the inside?
Mom.
She'll be proud of me.
She's an innie, I'm an outie.
Already got gotten kicked in the knee and smacked in the hand. And when I was a kid, I'm getting PTSD because I was kicked in the face by a donkey. That was fun.
And I did my very best. I really tried my best. I had something to prove to myself. I really did. I walked in there with something to prove. None of the ranchers, none of the farmers had that thought about me. My father-in-law didn't have that thought about me. I just had a need to prove to someone, to me, to them, it didn't matter, that I could be, that I could do this. And they're asking me, so what are you okay with doing? I'm like, you know what? I'll burn them. I'll stick injections in them. I'll do whatever you need me to do. And they say, okay, well, all right. Well, let's go ahead and send you into the pen. And the pen is stepping into mud created by their own pee and poo. And then taking them and directing them into the pen where then the table's going to flip up with them on it. And what you have to do is once you get them pushed into that little tiny area where they're waiting to go onto the table, you have to block them in with your body. And so you learn to shimmy it in to the into the area. Wayne was a big guy. The guy was all muscle, really big guy. And so when he covered up this hole that they could come out of, I mean, his body just engulfed this hole. There's no way they're going anywhere. He could lock them in tight. Me, I'm a much smaller guy than him, even though I feel like I'm fat on a normal day. And as I tried to pin them in, I just felt like I wasn't pushing them in as much as it was needed. And I learned the hard way. The first thing that happened within a couple cows that I got, I was starting to get used to it. I was feeling good about it. Suddenly one of them reared up and smacked me right in the knee. And I was like, oh, that hurt a little. It was a kick. It was a good kick. And I felt it on my knee and it was not fun. And they're like, you all right? I'm like, I'm great. Let's keep going. Trying to keep that. I've got something to prove to everyone else. Let's keep going. So I rubbed that off and got back into it. And then a couple cows later, I got hit again on my hand and on my pinky. My pinky is sore today from it just a bit. And it caught me off guard because how'd you hit my pinky on my hand? That caught me off guard. It happened a couple more times. I got smacked in the shin and stuff like that. But then there was one hit. Two hits, actually. One, I walked up, and I wasn't paying attention. I was talking to Wayne behind me, and I pushed the cow in, and I started walking in. Well, he had already reared up, and mid me walking into it, he kicked me square in the shin. And that one made me wince a bit. I'm sure I made a pretty loud noise. I look around, all the guys are looking at me. I'm like, I'm good. I'm great. Let's go. You need a break? No, I'm good. I'm great. And then we probably did 10 or 15 more. And then the smack of my day hit me. I don't know how it happened. You learn to kind of shuffle your butt against them and have them tuck their butt into the corner of the wall and in the side of you. And you're honestly wondering, there's two things that go through my mind at that moment in time. Do I want to get pooed on or do I want to get kicked? And the reason why I say that is because as your butt is up against their butt, you're realizing their butt is feeling really warm for some reason. And you're listening to the calves that are getting burned on the table with the iron, and it is very painful for them. It's a one feeling, one moment thing. They're only going to have this done once in their life. They're little babies, so they're probably not going to remember this very well when they get older, much like a little child getting its ears pierced or a little child getting circumcised. In that kind of a sense, you know, this is something that is, as they're a baby, they're getting this done now, so it's less painful for them in the future. It's not something they're going to hopefully remember, and they're going to become fun animals. They're going to become properly tamed animals, you know. That'll be good to where the little girl can literally walk through, you know. And as they're getting burned, it's throwing their body into shock to such an extent where they're literally pooping on the table. And my father-in-law, his job at the table was basically to hold their legs back so they wouldn't kick too hard. And by the end of the day, he was really sore because they were kicking with him trying to hold onto the leg. And they would literally poo on him. And if they have diarrhea or something, by the end of the day, he had poo lines down his jeans of where they just literally pooped on him because of the shock of getting burned with the iron. And so I've learned to lock them in, and their butts feel really warm, so you can't tell if they're pooing on you or if they're kicking you. And you have to make this decision in your mind. Do I want to be kicked really hard, or do I want to block them in and just deal with whatever is dripping down my ankle at this moment in time? I'd much rather deal with whatever's dripping down my ankle at this point in time, because I'm basically covered in it already. And so I got them all locked in. I'm doing really good. I'm talking with Wayne. I'm making sure they often would try to turn their heads around. And literally, they, in this tiny space, this wide, a humongous calf, I watched them literally do a 180 in there like a cat and then come back out the chute if you're not in there to block them in. So as I see the calf turning its head, I reach over and I push its head back so it stays looking forward. And it's looking forward. Everything's going good. But I start feeling a shuffling of its hooves and I'm going, what's going on? Suddenly, I notice one of its hooves is definitely off the ground and it comes slamming. And I mean, it was an all-out slam into my shin. And I am hurting today. I am hurting today in a big way because of that hit that hit my shin. And that one nearly put me on the floor. I grabbed the wall and I'm hanging onto it. And I'm like, oh, and just didn't. I had to recuperate myself. And I pushed the little guy in to get in there, you stupid little. Get him shoved in there. And the guys are all looking at me like, you okay? And I'm like, oh, you know, and I'm in pain and I'm not doing well here. And I'm like, I'm fine, just give me a second, you know, and Wayne, he looks over at me and he goes, hey, you need a break? And I'm thinking on this chip on my shoulder and this thing to prove to myself, and I'm going, I don't want to take a break, and, you know, kind of like, I don't want to wait, I don't want to take a break, and he goes, great, here's the next one, get in there, and I'm like, okay, let's get back into the chute, and I'm hurting, I got him pushed in there and stuff, And this is an everyday thing for these guys. I mean, they only do this once a year. But they deal with this kind of stuff. They deal with kicking calves and stuff. And this is Wayne, you looked at his arms, these big, massive arms that he has. And I could see scars all up and down his arms. And you could tell it was from different stuff that he's dealt with some of these animals and things that they've had. And I'm just sitting there just, you know, and just realizing that if I can't keep my act together here, and if I can't look somewhat sane in this moment in time, which I'm sure for them isn't a normal little, you know, like they've just gotten used to this. If I can't get my act together, then I'm just going to look stupid. So catch my breath a couple times, and then I get back in line, and I keep getting those animals pushed through. And there were a few times throughout the time that we were working on these cows that you look into the pins in the back, and you can see how many are left. And there were tons. I mean, it looked like a never-ending line. And the one thing I wanted to do so badly was just to stop and take a break and just to take a break. Let someone take over. Let Wayne do his job, because this is usually his job. But Wayne wasn't feeling as well. I heard him coughing a lot. He had a cold yesterday. And I'm like, well, I really still have something to prove to myself. I can make it through this. I can do this. And so I did my best and worked really hard. And everyone was really great. Let me tell you, those farmers are very amazing, friendly people. And it really is a bit of a culture shock. It is a different world out there. One of the things that one of the farmers noticed is that one of the calves hadn't been banded correctly, apparently, before, or something had happened where the band had slipped on them during the castration that they were doing for them. And so they had to do a little bit of surgery and literally cut the testicles out of the calf, and he bled just a little bit. And this is not to be gross. This is not to be gross. This is to show what farming is really like. He walks up to me and he says, hey, you need something to drink, son? And I said, that would be wonderful, sir. I'd greatly appreciate it. He's like, all right. He goes and he gets me a Diet Coke and he brings it over. And as he hands it to me, I see his hand is just covered in that blood. And he hands it to me and I take it and I go, thank you very much. And he walks away. I'm not grossed out. I'm not like checking the can for blood or whatever.
There's nothing better than Diet Coke while doing this. I'm beat. My shoulder is tired and my hip is tired, but I don't want to say anything in front of these guys because these guys have been doing it. This guy over here, his name is Wayne. He's been doing it since he was 8 years old. The last thing I want to do is stop because I've got a point to prove to myself and to all these guys, even though they're not trying to hold it over my head. But if you look over there, there's about 90 more head of calves.
But this is a normal life for them. This is what they're dealing with. This is what they're used to. And this is what they're doing to keep their families alive. This is what they're doing to properly take care of their animals. And this is what they're doing to help make a living, to put steak on the table for guys like me who absolutely love steak and stuff like that. And I took that can from him with a whole different outlook. Like I said, I wasn't grossed out. If he ever saw this, honestly, that image that I had in my mind was just so iconic and epic. It wasn't gross. It was, this is the true laborer. This is the true man who's working for his family and who's doing his job. I think about I don't like my generation. Millennials, we're a terrible bunch because honestly, we're so quick to judge. We're so quick to think that the world owes us something. And then I look at these guys. And I literally told Wayne a little later on, I said, Wayne, you know what? I honestly think that every millennial should come and work in a place like this for a month. And actually, I said a week and he said a month, and I agreed with him completely. This is a moment where maturity happens instantly, and you learn from this and you grow from this. And it was just such an awesome experience to have. And then after we got done with all the calves, and yes, I did make it through all the calves. I was very proud of myself. Then I started working on the cows. And the cows were much different. The cows are huge. They're scary. I don't know how the little girl walked through them. That was impressive. But then I watched as they directed all the cows down this big chute. And my job in the chute area there was basically just to have my little poker stick. And it wasn't a poker. It's just a big flimsy stick. And you just take them and you just tap them on the butt or tap them on the neck and just kind of direct them into the chute. And once they go through the chute, my father-in-law, Ed, was running a squirt gun, basically. And basically, if you guys have ever had a dog or a cat or whatever, you get flea treatments. And these flea treatments are a couple droplets that you put on the back of their neck. And it stays there, so they can't lick it or anything like that. And that, it takes care of the fleas or whatever treatment that is. Well, cows have that exact same thing. It's just in a much bigger dose. And so what my father-in-law, Ed, would do is he would squirt a long squirt down their back. And that's the exact same kind of stuff that you would be putting on your dog or cat. And then another rancher would have a very big needle gun, and it was all very, very clean. Anytime they would break a needle off or it would land on the ground because the cows are kicking while they're giving them injections, he would grab a new needle and put it on, screw it on, and then he'd take off the cap to show the needle itself. He wouldn't touch it. He wouldn't touch the needle. And then he'd go down each cow and he would give them an injection. And depending on what cows needed injections or other things, they were checked out, make sure that they were approved. If they noticed something uncertain about them, then they would go ahead and take a look at them, see if there was anything extra that needed to be done, and then they'd send them from the chute. The wonderful thing about all this in the end is that the calves and the cows were brought back together. throughout the whole day, you hear the cows calling for their calves. And at the end of the day, when they finally go through the chute, they go into the same field that all the calves are hanging out in. And you hear them start to moo for each other. Now, the way that cows and calves, as far as the farmer told me, is that they would sniff for each other, and they could sniff each other's scent out, and the moms and calves would find each other. And then once the day was over, we had a great time. We did some other stuff. We got to go tour on their property. We went and we found just some beautiful views off in the distance, some amazing vistas. We went into an area that had a boat just on the top of a hill, and then the Missouri River out in the distance. And this gentleman, who was the owner of the ranch, I think he said was started in 1912 or 1914 by his grandfather or something like that, which is amazing. I'm hoping I'm getting those years right or something of that nature. He said, yeah, I rode in this boat. This boat it's had three different motors in it and stuff, and we got something kind of cool in here called the geocache.
They had two or three different engines in this thing over the years.
And it's got a radiator block on it, of all things.
Yeah. This is...
geocache. You know what that is?
What do they call it?
Geocache.
Yeah, where it's a GPS. It's a notebook, any good anymore. Mm-hmm. We got to get over here and...
Get a new container.
Yeah, Emma just said an ice cream bucket. I never thought of that.
But anyway, people hike off the river and they sign the book. But we got to get it preserved and into something
cool.
You can actually read.
That's cool.
So sign your name.
Yeah. And he pulls a bag out of there and he starts pulling stuff out. Here's a ball cap, here's a shirt, and here's a little booklet. And he hands a little booklet to a little girl, the little girl who walked through all those cows. And she opens it for me and turns it at me while I point the camera at it. And here are different people who have used their phones and the GPS in their phones. And they've found this boat with this, what they call a geocache in it. And basically what they would do is they could keep something out of the bag if they wanted to keep the hat or the t-shirt, but they would have to give something of theirs in return for it. And so you read through the book and they'd say, hey, look, I took the hat and I left a granola bar or something like that. And it's just amazing. And basically they would go and check on this cache every now and then to see what's new and check the booklet. And they said, hey, Tim, you should sign this. So I grabbed my father-in-law's pen and I signed it.
Goodies, even?
Rattlesnake eggs.
Really?
Probably. What's not today's really. Day?
What is today? Today is...
18th,
isn't it? Yeah. Yep, 18th. March 18, 2017.
So, guys, basically, this is really cool. There's people that go along the water here. This is, the Missouri River, and basically they will come out here and find this by using a GPS. Probably you could probably do it on your phone, and you find this old boat that he used to be able to ride in. But like I said before, this is the country that all the cattle get to hang out in. This is, you know, as long as it's a safe country, this is where they feast on grass and things. The things that you saw at the farm today in the video that we did, that's only for one day out of everything that that they do. Basically, it's the doctor's appointment. And then they get all this, which is pretty cool. Not to mention, I mean, look at the mountains over there and stuff. Look at the quarries and everything. I mean, this place is just gorgeous. And this is my new home. These are the views I can come and enjoy. And I got to tour around the land, and that was really, really cool. At the end of the day, it was just a whole different experience. It was just so neat to see everything. And we had lunch with them. They made a big fancy lunch. And the little girl who's turning 10, they had a little birthday cake for her. And that was delicious. Talk about Northern care. They really went out of their way to take care of you and made sure that you were taken care of since you were helping them out. It was so cool. And at the end of the day, I learned that the cows, in a day or two, we're going to be moved into a field across the street, and that's a very large field. I think theirs is about 30 or 40 acres, and they call that an enclosure, but 30 or 40 acres is huge. That's a ton of land. for these cows to go and run as they see fit. And they're not going to be there for forever. They're only going to be there for 3 or 4 days. But the purpose that they are being moved over into that next field is for one purpose. And that's so that the moms and the calves can find each other. And the farmers will go and check on them 3 or 4 times a day to see if the moms have found the calves and making sure that the moms have accepted the calves back and are properly taking care of them. And then once that's done, then they move them into a big field. And that big field is hundreds upon hundreds of acres. And they take care of them. And basically, they go and they live their lives. They go and eat the wheat and go and have whatever's out there. The farmers will go out there. Wayne is a guy who goes out there often. And he takes oat and stuff like that out there. And he feeds them by hand so they can keep them tamed. And they'll come up to him and feed from him and stuff. And then next year, I'll be back there again, most likely, and we'll do this all over again. And what an exciting adventure. Thank you so much for joining me, guys. I hope that you've enjoyed this. Remember, get subscribed on Life with Thrive if you want to see more, as I keep finding more opportunities to experience things that I swear I never would have thought I would have done in my life. You can also check us out on Facebook at Life with Thrive, and get followed to us on there. Hit the like button and leave a comment. We love getting your comments on the Life of Thrive page. If you have any friends who you think would be interested in this, share this out to them as well. That would mean a lot to me. If you have any friends who are animal lovers, I understand that there are some things here that they will not want to see, and that's fine. This is for people who appreciate your meat, who appreciate their steaks, and certainly who have a love to see animals well taken care of. That's what I saw at this ranch. So it was a very cool experience. God bless you guys. Thank you so much for hanging out with me. I hope this wasn't too boring for you. And I will see you next time in our next video. God bless y'all. You're beautiful, amazing people. Keep being brave. I'll see you next time.
It's done in the north.